One, two, three.
Hello, welcome to Rock the Cash Bar. I'm Ben Mowbray.
And I'm Diane Gallagher.
Every week we pick one song and do a deep dive into the lyrics and explain the different ways they've been interpreted.
We will also discuss how the song connected to us on a personal level, focusing on all the embarrassing details.
Glad to have you here. Enjoy the show.
Welcome to the Cash Bar once again, you guys. That is not Ben.
Not Ben. Changing my name right now.
That is James Yasko. We've had him on before. We did, oh dang it, what was the name of the band we did? The Pernice Brothers.
Pernice Brothers, Water Band.
Yes, yes, which was really, really great. So Ben is frolicking, I think, on a river or something. He's on vacation this week with people he works with. So it's just me and James today. James,
is it like the Frio, or is it like the Trinity River, or is it like the Mississippi?
And he's going, I think
like
they do Frio. I think they go Guadalupe, maybe.
Oh,
at least
that's
what it was last year.
Like, we don't need Ben to Jeff Buckley himself and decide to like get in the Mississippi and never be seen again.
yeah. I don't think Mississippi is his that's his vibe. I don't think being outdoors during the day is his vibe usually, but he's doing it.
Definitely not mine.
Yeah, he's a nighttime bartender. That's his, he's a bat.
So he's just waking up around now. Like, that's a normal thing.
Yeah, probably. Yeah. I think he's trying to be like, no, I get up at like, sometimes I'll text him and he'll answer me at like 9 a.m. And I'm like, whoa. but if he worked the night before, I mean, he struggles at 1 o'clock sometimes when we're podcasting. Like, this hurts.
I'm sure. Yeah.
Yeah. I can't do it at all. If I go to bed at 4, like I'm out the whole next day. Like, bye. No.
Oh, I'm gonna poop weird for a week. Like, it's gonna take like a month to get like regulate like just aches in my body. Like, yeah, no. I see 2 o'clock in the morning, it's too early. It's not too late.
Mm-mm. It's beer shits and depression. Yeah, I can't do it anymore. Hate it. So you guys know James from being on this podcast and from his own podcast, Lima Time with co-host Patrick McClellan, who has also been on the podcast. So you guys know this guy.
Old friends.
And you're a Patreon member. Thank you so much. And we drew your name. And tell us what song you picked for us to discuss.
So we picked, and it's iconic in every single way. And the Water Band, so the Pernice Brothers, when we talked about me coming on for a few weeks, if I remember correctly. This has been a couple of years now.
Yeah.
And it took me weeks to come up with it, because I was trying to find like the sweet spot of like what's something that people might not have heard of, but it's still like it's a banger.
Yeah.
But it's still kind of under the radar. And this time I went the complete opposite direction, and it took me like, I think I was like, oh, hang on, let me think. And then like 2.5 minutes later, I'm like, Freedom 90 by George Michael. Let's go.
I was like, all right, he is sure of himself. Yes. Yeah. So why?
Everything about that song is freaking cool. It just, the way that it starts out and I did a little bit of research, and I'm like the straightest guy in America that knows what the other guy in Wham's name was. and so like, it's Andrew Ridgely. Andrew Ridgely is the other guy in Wham. And so like, I'm a Wham fan, and I didn't put it together until fairly recently that they had a song called Freedom.
Yes.
That also slaps, and it's just sugary, sweet, cavity inducing pop music.
Yeah.
And so then I was like, oh wait, this is called Freedom 90. It's like a different kind of freedom, but I mean, the song just goes so hard. It's like six and a half minutes long.
It's long. I did not realize until getting back into it today. I was like, I have two columns of lyrics, and then like listening to the song, I was like, this song was long.
It was really long. Like, everyone thought Bohemian Rhapsody was like a super long song, and this is like a good 30 seconds to a minute longer than Bohemian Rhapsody.
Yeah.
So, but like, it doesn't, there's not a point at which I've listened to the song, and I've listened to it a lot, where I was like, this could be a minute and a half shorter. Like, everything, like it all, like for me, and everyone's mileage may vary, but for me, it's a perfect song. Like the even the, and I'm sure we'll get into it, but the way that it kind of feels like a bridge, they're sort of in the middle, and you think, okay, well, this is about to wind down. And then no, it just continues with the bridge. Mm-hmm. And it's like the second half of this song. And then the video, like, I mean, we've got to get into the video, because yes, the video is just absolutely incredible.
Yes, it's, yeah. We'll get into all that. There's just so much hotness, and there's a funny, ironic thing about what he was trying to pull away from with MTV, but also was just doing with other people. So
right. He let other people do what he was doing and sang about it while they did it.
Yeah. Let them lip sync the words that, yeah. So before we get into lyrics, I don't think I asked you last time, and I'm dying to know, who are your people? What's a Yasko? Like, what is, where are you guys from?
Oh, like the Yaskos?
Yeah.
Ukraine.
Ukraine.
Eastern Russia, Ukraine. Okay. So when about maybe 12 years ago, we went to Ellis Island. And we were in New York City, and we're like, we got to go to Ellis Island. Like, I'm a history teacher. Like, that's cool. Like, we got to go. And they had like a little database where you could search, and you could find, because they have everyone's like records, their immigration records that ever passed through Ellis Island.
Yeah.
So I spent maybe an hour. Like, I let everybody else just kind of walk around, and I'm like, oh, cool. Ellis Island, neat. I'm going to go look for who were the first Yaskos to come to America. And so I spent like an hour and a half, and I'm searching. I just looked for Yasko, and I went through like card after card after card. And we get on the ferry to go back to Manhattan, and I couldn't find it. And we were on the ferry, and I bet we'd kind of set off from Ellis Island maybe 30 seconds before I'm like, freaking moron. It was probably like Yaskovich.
Yes.
And they just shortened it because like the immigration officers were like, what's your name? No, it's not. This is what it is now. And so I had occasion, I don't know, 3 or 4 years ago to go back to New York City and went to Ellis Island again. And I came a little bit more prepared, and I found it. So they came, they left from, I want to say it was Lithuania, Abram Yaskovich and his wife, that if I'd thought that this might go in this direction, I could have looked that up, but they got here in like 1909, and came through Ellis Island and then immediately went to Southern Tennessee. For some reason.
Yeah, that's interesting. My family, like my mom's side, came and they all just went straight to the South, like Alabama. Like, we were Alabama people on that side. But and my dad was adopted, and I just recently through 23andMe found that whole side of my family, which was Portuguese.
And oh, that's cool.
Yeah. My great grandfather like came over from the Azores on a lightweight featherweight boxing visa. And
that's incredible.
Yeah, it was pretty cool, except he went fucking nuts, and they don't know if it was punch drunk or if he just had schizophrenia, but it went bad. He had to be committed. It was not good.
It's still a pretty cool part of the story though.
Yeah it is. But what the funniest part is, I knew my whole life I was a fourth something that started with a P. My family just, they're like, oh, I think his mom was a Polynesian woman, or no, she was Filipino. And finally I found my relatives, and we're Portuguese. So from the Azores.
That's awesome.
I don't know. It was so cool for me because I always just wanted to know. I just wanted to know, like, what am I? My dad's like dark complected. And I can get really dark in the summer, but my mom's like a blonde and fair skinned. I'm like, what am I? So finally know. I'm Portuguese.
That's really cool. Yeah, I don't have, I mean, yeah, there's Ukraine, and then my mom is straight up 100% British. So
okay.
Yeah.
That's fun.
So my dad's like, I don't know, 6'1", like 280 from Lubbock. And my mom's 5'0" with red hair and an English accent from like the middle of England.
Nice.
Yeah.
That's fun. All right. Back to away from ancestry.com, because I could talk about that for a long time. My family history is fucking bonkers.
I'm a history teacher. Like, we could just do this. Like, this is, I'm perfectly in my element, right?
We're just like throwing freedom out. Let's talk about ancestry.
Let's talk about Prince Henry the Navigator, one of the more famous Portuguese.
Yeah. That's awesome. I'd be all ears. Okay. Oh, it's a lot of lyrics here. And at one point I'm going to be like, okay, you get it. He's going to repeat himself here. So, but
yeah, it's very repetitive. Yes.
Yeah. God, I hate doing Ben's job. I'm a bad reader. I have a fat tongue. I get mush mouth, but I'm going to do my best. All right. I won't let you down. I won't give you up. Gotta have some faith in the sound. It's the one good thing I've got. I won't let you down, so please don't give me up, because I would really, really love to stick around. Oh, yeah. I like that. I feel like right off the block, like, we know that he's talking about his career. Yeah. Do you think?
Yeah, no, it's not written for one person. It's written for everybody who's going to listen to the song. Like, it's sort of a love letter / breakup letter.
Yes.
But love letter again to everyone who listened to Wham or to Faith or to whatever, you know, father figure. I can't remember which one. I don't know where in the discography Freedom 90 falls. But yeah, no, it's to everybody. It's a personal song, but it's not written to one person.
Right. So the background is, he was trying to break up with Sony, and, you know, Faith had come out before. That whole album was wildly popular, and it was so popular, it kind of broke him a little bit. He went into a depression, and, it was hard on him, and he was trying to change the image and have a different artistic vision, and Sony didn't like it. They wanted Faith again. They wanted to stay on that train, and he wanted to change. But so that's
because that was late 80s, right? I mean, like,
yeah, 88, I think. Yeah.
Yeah.
And this was 90, like, you know, the song says Freedom 90. And so this, you know, he's trying to go a different direction. And so we can go ahead and talk about the video at the same time. Faith was just so all about, like, how hot he was, you know, his butt in the jeans and yep.
The leather jacket. Can't mm-hmm. forget the leather jacket.
The leather jacket, the guitar. And so in this video, he made a conscious choice to not put himself in the video and instead put all the supermodels of the time lip singing to his song. Yep. And man, we don't do the supermodel thing anymore. We don't celebrate them anymore. But I was watching the video today. And so for those who remember, it was Cindy Crawford, Naomi Campbell, Linda Evangelista, Christy Turlington, and I don't know how to say Tatiana Patsitz. I don't know.
Sure.
Sure. And some male models that were in the video. And I feel like they never got their up and comings. But so he put them in the video instead, and he's not in the video at all. And in the video, his jacket that he wore in Faith catches on fire. His guitar explodes, and the motorcycle as well, something.
And the jukebox.
And the jukebox, yes. Yes.
So he's blowing all of that up, like, in this video that he's not in.
Yeah. Yeah. He's very much making a point of, I want to separate myself from that. I want to move on.
And it's one thing that's interesting, because I also, we as a family, we watched a few videos, Wham videos last night. And, you know, because, like, our daughter knows, like, Wake Me Up Before You Go-Go and all that. And we watched it, and we were like, oh, that's really fun for the 80s. And this is also very ridiculous, but it's extremely fun, which I feel like. Yeah. So it was very appropriate, you know, for the time. And then, you know, we watched the Faith video, and the hair is not feathered anymore, and no. He's got some stubble, and he's got the sunglasses, because in, like, the Wake Me Up video, super clean shaven, highlights, feathered hair, you know, neon colors. And you kind of see this, I don't know that he wanted it had to have been a conscious choice, because it's George Michael. And if you're that pretty of a human being, like, you know exactly what you're doing every time you're on camera. But it was a little bit edgier of a look for the Faith video. And then he's sort of not even in this one at all. So it's sort of like there's this transition from Wham to him as a solo artist and sort of breaking up with everything that was in the past.
Yeah, I think in the Wham episode that we did in December, because we did Last Christmas, I didn't realize he played all the instruments. He played all the instruments on that. Isn't that what, like, people don't, I think he wasn't getting the respect of being a writer and a musician as much as, like, being a pretty face. And he didn't like that.
And he talks about this later in the song. Yeah.
Right. Yeah. And a little history, I think we talked about before, but Andrew, how do you say Andrew's last name?
Ridgely.
Ridgely. In the beginning, because they were like schoolmates, he was the one who was flamboyant and, you know, out, and he's the one who taught George Michael, like, here's how you do your hair. Here's how you have charisma. Here's how you be a front leading man. And so it wasn't like in him. He wasn't like the guy in high school getting all the girls. And, you know, we find out later, you know, he's gay, but he said right. You know, he was both, you know, he said when he was writing songs about women, he meant it. They were about women. They weren't like secretly about men and stuff. So, but, yeah, so I think it makes sense. Like we talk about how pretty he is, but it made me laugh in my research. He was saying like MTV had really changed the face of music. It wasn't enough to have a great voice anymore. You had to be the whole package. And he just didn't want to play that game anymore. Which is, I respect it, but also when you are as good looking as George Michael, I was like, I don't know if you're the one to spearhead this movement.
Right. Yeah. No, it's really easy to be like, it shouldn't be about looks when you're just handsome as hell. Yeah. That's a pretty easy, that's a layup for sure.
Yeah. Yeah. And then he's like, but also let me put the most beautiful women in the world in my video instead. which, you know, it's old. That, I mean, I remember 1990. I remember that video constantly on my television. Yeah.
I was 10 in 1990. And that was the first time that I watched a video and I was like, there's something going on physically with my body right now. And I can't quite put my finger on what that is.
I can't look away. And I just have like, I don't know how to pinpoint. Yeah. My
pants are very tight. I know that my pants are tight.
My high school boyfriend, the video for him that made that happen was Girls on Film by Duran Duran.
Oh yeah. 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 That's a good
one. Lots of like legs walking across the screen. Yep. He said he was like, huh, something's happening. Yeah. I think I like Girls on Film.
Yep. Yeah. Everybody that was old enough to watch MTV has a video just like that.
Yeah. That's a good one. I want the listeners to like message us on any of the socials and tell us the, especially just guys, what video on MTV turned your sexuality knob like straight up.
I can't wait to find, because I don't know what the demographics of your listenership is. I feel like they're fairly similar if I've been on twice now. but how many dudes are like, I ain't listening to no George Michael, and then they're moved to watch the video because of this. They're like, okay, I get it now.
Yeah.
And yeah. So I want to know. I'd like to be kept in the loop on the feedback of this episode.
Yeah. Yeah. Okay. I'll keep going. Cause like I said, a lot of lyrics. Heaven knows I was just a young boy. Didn't know what I wanted to be. I was every little hungry schoolgirl's pride and joy. And I guess it was enough for me. I guess it was enough for me. To win the race, a pretty face, brand new clothes, and a big fat place on your rock and roll TV. Heaven knows I was just a young boy, didn't know what I wanted to be. Then he repeats that. I was every little hungry schoolgirl's pride and joy, and I guess it was enough for me. To win the race, a prettier face, brand new clothes, and a big fat place on your rock and roll TV. But today, the way I play the game is not the same. No way. I'm gonna get myself happy. I had a misheard song lyric here. I always thought he said, I think I'm gonna make them happy, but he was saying the exact opposite. He's like, I'm tired of making them happy. It's time to make me happy.
Yeah, no, it's a very, I'm not an artist. Like I don't have any idea what the songwriting process is. And as certainly no one's paying me to be on camera. So, because I look like this, and but that's a really bold, I mean, in 1990, coming off the heels of Faith, which in my head was like a worldwide hit. Like that, I haven't looked at charts or anything like that, but I would assume that that was popular on both sides of the Atlantic. To be like, no, that's not how I'm going to do it anymore. Like that's, and to, it's the ultimate baller move to take a shot at MTV, and then MTV plays you taking a shot at MTV 24 hours a day for however long it was a staple in the rotation. Like that, that's just really cool to me.
Yeah. Well, and I'll say in doing the research, this specific verse is, he's specifically talking about his time with Wham. Cause he goes back and talks about like in 1984 doing Wham, he's like, I didn't know who I was. Young girls were putting my picture on the wall, like a clean David Cassidy look. And he's like, I felt like I was a safe person for them to do that with. Like, I'm not going to be the guy like putting my hand up their skirt is what he said.
Nice. Yeah.
Good. But he hadn't come into himself yet and, you know, was probably hiding his sexuality at that time. And he said, you know, he did hide it for a long time for his mother. It wasn't even for the fans, like, you know, because still back in the 90s, being gay at that time had so much stigma around it associated with HIV. And he did not want to scare his mother that, because he's like, that's all she would think about is that I was going to die from AIDS. So it was after she died, I think in 97. And then he got caught with, you know, the lewd thing. He got busted.
Oh, that's right. I forgot about that.
And that was 98. And that's when he just went ahead and came out. And he was like, oh, all right, well, I'll just tell everybody now. And he didn't really care anymore.
When was the concert for Freddie Mercury?
Oh, I don't know.
It couldn't have been as early as, I mean, I guess it, I feel like there would be some overlap between like the Freedom 90 video and the Freddie Mercury concert. I could totally see how there would be, I mean, the stigma, of course, I mean, you know, we both grew up at various mm-hmm. points in the '80s that, mm-hmm. that the stigma of being gay and then what HIV does to you, and it's Magic Johnson and it's Freddie right. Mercury. And, you know, to be willing to confront that, like that's a pretty brave thing.
Yeah. I mean, it's still brave now. I mean, it's getting so much better now, but God, to me, like the 90s don't feel that far away, but they really are.
No, I don't, I don't know if you've seen these where like, hey, if Varsity Blues was like the time span comparisons, like we're as far away from Varsity Blues was as like, you know, a Dazed and Confused was from the actual 1970s. Like, ugh. Like those stress, and I don't know if the math actually works out, but that stresses me out. Like, I don't care for that. Like, there's no way I'm in my 40s. Like, I'm clearly 28. Like, and I've been 28 for a good 15 years.
I know. It blows my mind that and when I was growing up, the time, just like the way the world changed between 1960 and 1990 was so vast to me. Like to me, that was like 50 years ago and not like a 30 year difference. And now I look at the 30 year difference between 90s and now, and I'm like, oh.
Yeah, we're talking like Nevermind to now is the same as 1960 to 1990. The concert insane. For Freddie Mercury was 92, April of 92.
Okay. Okay.
So it's still before. Mm-hmm. There isn't really the stigma. I mean, there's the stigma, but it wasn't so much on the forefront of the public consciousness right. as it would be, you know, 2 years later.
Yeah, for sure. Okay, so he talks about Wham. And now it goes into, I think there's something you should know. I think it's time I told you so. There's something deep inside of me. There's someone else I've got to be. Take back your picture in a frame. Take back your singing in the rain. I just hope you understand sometimes the clothes do not make the man. This was interesting when I was just reading this and I didn't know the history of this. It felt like to me him trying to come out. But it's not, I don't think.
Yeah, and it's been long enough. I mean, it came out 33 years ago that I started paying attention to the song after we knew everything we knew about George Michael. That's what I assumed as well.
Right. But I don't think it is. It's him talking about wanting to change his image and how he's viewed as an artist. So yeah, I'm really scrutinizing the lyrics, like take back your picture in the frame, where he's like, I want you to see me in a different way. Take back your singing in the rain. Is that from Faith?
Does he sing
in the rain in that video? I don't know.
No, he's just in like the studio with the jukebox and the guitar and the leather jacket.
Okay. But yeah, we get sometimes the clothes do not make the man. So he's like, that wasn't who I am.
Right.
Basically. Yeah. Did you know about the letter? I should probably wait till the end of this, but do you know about the letter that Frank Sinatra wrote him about this? Remind me. I'm going to wait, because after we're done with the song, we're going to talk about how he had decided he didn't tour with this album and he didn't want to do interviews anymore. He's like, I'm done doing that. And he was vocal about that. And then he stuck to it. He didn't do an interview for like 6 years. Sinatra wrote him a letter, a public letter addressing this, telling him he's making a mistake. But I'll get back to that.
We'll get into that. Yeah, for sure.
Okay, so now we get into basically the chorus, which is in kind of two chunks. All we have to do now is take these lies and make them true somehow. All we have to see is that I don't belong to you and you don't belong to me. Is he talking about him and Sony or him and his fans?
I have always thought, and I feel like you've done more research, like actual research into the song than I have, other than I listened to it quite a bit. I always interpreted that as that's him to his fans. Okay. That this is who I was when you fell in love with the music mm-hmm. that I create. And I'm not that guy. And I read, someone gave me, Andrew Ridgely wrote essentially an autobiography of his time in Wham with George Michael. And I've read part of it. I have not, I need to find it. I read it and I was like, this is cool. And then I immediately lost the book.
Oh.
But one thing that I remember is that like Andrew Ridgely wrote it and he was like, we always knew there was going to be a solo career. Like, mm-hmm. And so the Wham part was just to like get him known and use that as a launching pad. And Andrew Ridgely was like, and I was totally cool with it. Like it was not a big deal when he was like, that's it. We were like, yep. Sounds good. Like that makes sense. Go do your thing.
Very healthy ego of Andrew.
Yeah. Well, I mean, he's getting royalties off of Wake Me Up Before You. Like, I mean, he's set. Like I firmly believe that if you can be catchy for 3 minutes, you do not have to work again for a day in your life.
Yeah.
So I think I always interpret that as like, hey, this is who you like. You're listening to this song because you liked Faith and you liked all of the Wham stuff. But that's not really how it's going to go from here on out.
Yeah. He's like, I'm a growing boy. I'm changing. I'm evolving. And I would like you to come with me. I think it is a love letter to his fans where he's like, I'm not trying to leave you. I want you to come with me on this journey. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah. And fans usually do, you know, we did a big Depeche Mode episode a couple episodes ago and, you know, Dave Gahan went through his own struggles and they were a band who wanted to change every single album and evolve and they wanted the fans to come with them. And sometimes Diane did not like it. I didn't want to go on the journey with them because I didn't like it. But yeah, George Michael just stayed great. I mean, this song was so big. It was so huge. And I think the fans kind of respected it. Like, okay, yeah, no, we're still with you. You're still hot, unfortunately. We know you are.
You know, I know you wish you weren't. You wish you were the Hunchback of Notre Dame with a golden voice. But you were clearly put on this earth to sing on stage. Like, sorry about it. Like, that is the millstone around your neck.
Yeah. Yeah. And he doesn't mention any mention in here that like, hey guys, I'm also struggling mentally because, you know, I read that he was really struggling with how big he had become with Faith and that tour and all the interviews and everything. And I think, you know, having a little bit of an identity crisis and, you know, hiding who, you know, his authentic self was, is probably hard. And they said he went through a little bit of a depression, and that's when he started smoking weed. And it's so funny how that's the only drug he ever did. He never went anything further. Like, he was just a pothead. Which is great.
And God bless him. God bless him for it.
Yeah. Freedom. Freedom. Okay, so the second big part of the chorus where he just says, freedom, I won't let you down. Freedom, I will not give you up. Freedom, gotta have some faith in the sound. Where this is where he's like, come with me, fans. We're gonna change the sound a little bit, but like, I'm gonna please you and just stay with me. You've got to give for what you take. These are like in parentheses where he's not finishing his sentence.
Yeah, there's a little call and repeat as it goes.
Yeah, it's weird to read. So yeah, he just kind of repeats those lyrics. You've got to give for what you take. So yeah, he's just asking his fans, like, come with me on this ride, but I'm still here.
And the ironies of the song is that you got to have some faith in the sound. Meanwhile, it's just this thumping rolling bass, huge cymbals. Like, it's a good sound. Like, it's not he's singing this over like a 7-year-old playing a recorder in the background.
Right.
Like, the song, like, sonically, like, holds up after 33 years.
Right. He's not suddenly playing like a theremin and going, I'm going in this weird direction, come with me.
You know? Right. Right. I wear tights and I play a guitar now. I hope you can get up, come on board. Like, no, this is one of the coolest sounding songs of the entire decade. Like, come along, won't you? And of course, everyone's going to be like, okay.
Yeah.
And yeah, we all did.
And he's a very outspoken lover of pop music. He was like, I was never trying to do anything different but be a pop music singer. Yeah.
And there's pop, and I think we might have even talked about this when I was on last, that pop music, like, I have two genres that just straight up ring my bell, and it's the bourbon soaked sad bastard music. It's Jason Isbell. It's Wilco. I'm a white dad in my 40s. Like, of course I'm into Jason Isbell and like Wilco and and stuff like that. But it's also like the sugary sweet pop music. Like, I freaking love it. And it gets a bad rap, but it like, pop is short for popular. Like, that people like it. So why would you, it's fun to be a hipster about music to an extent, but it's even more fun to be like, no, Blank Space by Taylor Swift is freaking great. like Shake It Off is fantastic. Like, I the love song by Sara Bareilles, it's like awesome. Like, give it to me all day, every day.
Right. And yeah, even as me, as sometimes I'm the curmudgeon who doesn't just like the formulaic, you know, overproduced thing, but man, when an earworm gets you, like, I remember the first one that I just immediately bowed down was the Alan Thicke, what's his son? Robin Thicke. I know you want it. And I was just like,
The Blurred Lines.
I was like, here we go. I'm in. I'm 100% in with this song. It brought me joy that whole summer that it came out.
Yeah, no, and also a very sexy video. Yeah.
Yeah.
So there's something to go along with. Yeah. If you have a sweet beat and a hot girl on camera, you're probably gonna make some money.
You're gonna do well.
Yeah.
All right. Let's see. Next line. Hey, Heaven knows we sure had some fun, boy. Again, he's talking about Wham again, because I remember reading this. What a kick, just a buddy and me. What a kick, just a buddy and me. We had every big shot, good time, band on the run. Boy, we were living in a fantasy. We won the race, got out of the place. I went back home, got a brand new face for the boys on MTV. But today, the way I play the game has got to change. Now I'm going to get myself happy. So I don't know. It feels like some, in a way though, he's making this big, like, I'm not in Wham anymore. I'm going to change. But I'm like, but you're still really hot and famous.
Yeah. And I'm going to spend, I'm breaking up with Wham, but I'm going to spend 3.5 minutes talking about Wham.
Yeah. It is. It's a love letter, not only to his fans, but to Wham. Like, that was great. We had a good time, but I didn't know who I was when I was with Wham. But I made a lot of money figuring it out.
Right, right, right. And you traveled the world.
Yeah.
And I think I think there's an element of truth to it, but I also think he's sort of reminding the listener, like, hey, what, I mean, he's not wrong. I mean, I if you think of like who, and I think there's the good time band, that's a clear delineation. Like, you're saying, like, we weren't as big as U2, Def right. Leppard, you know, but if you just wanted to have some fun, it didn't get much better than Wham.
Yeah.
I mean, like, maybe Cyndi Lauper, maybe Bananarama, but not they weren't as big as Wham. Like, no. I mean, he's right.
Yeah. Oh, it's funny. Just a side note, my husband says at his funeral, he wants us to play Wake Me Up Before You Go Go. As everyone's leaving. Which I always think is so funny. And then he wants his tombstone to say, it could be worse.
I love that. I love everything about that. Awesome.
Yeah. So we have plans. Okay. All right. Now there's this other, like, this song goes on, like, you think it's over. It's not over. Now we're going. Now he's saying some more stuff. I think there's something you should know. I think it's time to, I've stopped the show. There's something deep inside of me. There's someone I forgot to be. Take back your picture in the frame. Don't think I'll be back again. I just hope you understand sometimes the clothes do not make the man. I think in this part is where he's hinting at, I don't want to tour and I don't want to do interviews anymore, which he says out loud later.
Yeah. And there's, if I remember correctly, as an avid listener of the song, this is where, like, the bass becomes, I mean, the bass kind of starts off driving the song.
Right.
But this is where it's the predominant, I think there's like maybe a hi-hat like cymbal that's kind of going on and helping keep the beat. But this is like a super bass heavy. And it would be fun to know, like, I mean, of course, every decision that's made by George, that it's a conscious decision, but it takes sort of a different turn at this point in the song, and just the way that it sounds and what instruments are kind of driving the train.
Yeah, it's purposeful, because he's like, hey, I'm making a point here and I need you to pay attention. Like, I mean this.
And I want you to listen, but also want you to, like, be air basing in the car, like,
it's also catchy. This. He knows how to write a catchy hit. Like, everybody knows that. I think there's something you should know. Yeah, I mean, everybody, like, remembers this part of the song. So then he goes into the chorus again, and then after the chorus, well, it looks like the road to heaven, but it feels like the road to hell. And I think this is where he's talking about the depression he got with how big he got with fame. When I knew which side my bread was buttered, I took the knife as well. Posing for another picture, everybody's got to sell. But when you shake your ass, they notice fast. And some mistakes were built to last.
That's heavy. Like, that. There's a lot there.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's not just, so it's gone from, like, Wham, that was fun, But I'm not Wham. And now it's like, I'm not even, I'm not even Faith. Like, I'm not the mm-hmm. solo hit that, that started this second career. Like, that's not me either.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, literally when he's talking about when you shake your ass, he's talking about the Faith video.
Yep.
And some mistakes were built to last. I don't know how to break down that line. Like, does he think that was a mistake?
If you hear thumping in the background, it's my dog itching himself, like maybe 4 feet away. Yeah. Hey, Bob.
Stop. I know that sound. If my Frenchie were in here right now, it would just be like, is there a pig in your podcast room?
I don't know how you could reasonably, if you're George Michael in 1990 or 1989 after the Faith video and the worldwide stardom that had already been there and had sort of evolved. I kind of wonder what happened that you would sort of classify that as a mistake. Was it just like, was the filming of the Faith video, like just something like he did the ass shaking and it was, they were like, oh, that like is a joke. And everyone was like, no, that's good. Like let's do that. Let's do that all throughout this video. And he's like, oh, okay. Like
there had to have been a director being like, more ass shaking, more. And he's like, oh, I feel comfortable with this.
Okay. It's like, it kind of looks like, yeah, it's pretty good. All right. Yeah. All right. I'll go with it.
Yeah.
That's a weird line.
Yeah, it is. Well, also I think he may be calling it a mistake because it kind of hurt his mental stability. Like he went through a depression, but he's like, it was built to last because it made him huge. It made him super successful. Even more successful than he already was. We should mention that the director for this video for Freedom was David Fincher, who also did like
David Fincher.
Yeah. And this was like before he had done feature films like Fight Club, Benjamin yeah. Button and Social Network and such. Like he did this before all that, which is really, I was like, it's really cool. And when you watch the video, it's well done. It's
super well done. Yes.
Yeah. It's very, very cinematic. And I mean, these models were beautiful, like in a potato sack sitting down cross-legged in a field, but he really, really
played it up. Yeah.
Yeah. It was gorgeous. Even Cindy Crawford was
on YouTube, and it's been a while since I've seen it, but there's like a 15 minute like making of the Freedom 90 video.
Ooh.
Documentary that the supermodels talk about what it was like, and they're like, we just got this frantic phone call like in the middle of the night, and they're like, we want you to come lip sync to this George Michael song. And like the building was like absolutely freezing, and like half of them almost got pneumonia because they're all like 65 pounds and right. 5'11".
Yeah.
But it's so I'm gonna end up having to watch that little documentary again tonight after we get done here. But yeah. So
yeah. Well, apparently they had just been, those exact women in the video had just been on the cover of Vogue, and it was either George Michael or the director was like, those women, no substitutions. I saw the word no substitution. He's like, I want those women in my video. And they all agreed to it. And yeah, Cindy Crawford was saying, you know, it wasn't like this big party or big hang. They filmed separately. And she was like, oh, but she knew like what other girls were doing. And she was like, I'm in a bathtub with a towel on my head. Like they get to do all these other like cool things. And then she said when she saw the video, she's like, oh no, that's pretty cool. What the guy the director did with me was very cool. Because she's hot too. I mean, I was sitting there watching it trying to be like, which one's the hottest? Which one? And like Evangelista is gorgeous, but I was like, I just always had a thing for Cindy Crawford. And she back then, Cindy Crawford, oh my God. I was like, yeah, that's who I wish I looked like. She was my favorite.
One of my favorite, and this is an aside because I know you're a U2 fan, and mm-hmm. and I get regularly roasted on Astro Twitter for liking U2. I had the
U2 massive. What are you talking about? It's not like they're Coldplay or something.
I have opinions on
and Coldplay. I love Coldplay.
Yeah. I had the U2 channel on XM like as a preset on our car, and then my wife's like, please change something else, like you know what the number is, you can get to it if you want to, but please. And so but I read this I went into I was in a real big YouTube phase, like late high school, kind of all through college. And I read this biography of U2 on the Zoo TV tour. Mm-hmm. And Bono asked Adam Clayton, the bass player from U2, and he's like, you could have anything in the world right now, what would it be? And I think they were in like Italy or something like that on tour. And Adam Clayton said Naomi Campbell. And Bono took the U2 jet, picked up Naomi Campbell, and flew immediately back. And he's like, here you go. And they ended up dating for a little while.
I was that's a pretty say, baller was move. She dating someone who was like, sorry, buddy, my guy wants her for a second.
I don't know. I don't know. I'd like to hear more of that story, but that's something that stuck with me for, I don't know, a good 20 years, apparently.
Oh my gosh. That's quite the ego and like taking the God mic for Bono being like, done. Got it.
All right. Yeah. No, you shot your shot. I asked you a question. You answered it. I guess I have to because I'm Bono.
Yeah. Man, Supermodels just had the heyday in the 90s. I think about Chris Isaak's Wicked Game. I mean, everybody was throwing Supermodels in their videos. It was a good time for them.
And George Michael started the trend.
Mm-hmm.
He's like, yep. Who knew? People who are pretty look good on camera. How about that? We've uncovered.
It's so funny to me that he was like, I don't like what, you know, MTV, you have to be the whole package now. But I was like, but you're contributing to it.
Right, right. Everyone's like, you damn right, you gotta be pretty, because this is awesome.
Yeah, they're like, we love it. Just buy Leonard Skinner, nobody wants to look at you anyway.
Dwayne Allman head ass.
Yeah, Conway Twitty. That's what you get. That's what you get. That's what you get. See, that's what you get. See, that's what you get. Changing your mind. That's what you get for changing. That's what you get. That's what you get. He says that a lot, for changing your mind. And I'm like, is he talking to himself? Is this call and return to himself? That's what you get. That's what you get. I say, that's what you get for changing your mind. That's what you get. And after all this time, I just hope you understand. Sometimes the clothes do not make me.
I don't know. That's one of the coolest parts of this, of the song. And I that's at that point that I just try to match George Michael vocally, which is impossible. But I will absolutely blow out my vocal cords trying to get there. I've got a very funny random story about this that we don't necessarily need to.
Yeah, we do.
Maybe. Okay. Now it's yeah, actually at this part of the song. So I'm a soccer coach. I coach the girls' soccer team at my high school. And I was walking to school. It was after our season ended. So I wasn't really as much in a hurry because we didn't have early morning practice. And I had my AirPods in, and I had just got an email that we had three girls selected like academic all state. Mm-hmm. And that was really cool, especially for like the type of school that I teach in. And so like, I was in a really good mood, and I went to go put my lunch up in the teacher's lounge. And it was like 7:30. I mean, it was a good hour before school started. Didn't expect really anyone to be there. And so like, I'm listening to Freedom 90 as I'm going to the teacher's lounge, to the fridge. And I open the door, and it's at this point where I'm like, that's what you get for changing your mind. And I'm like loud, because I think I'm the only one there. And I open the door and I walk in on the faculty prayer breakfast. And I've been straight up hollering all down the hallway, and credit to them for not being like, let's let Yasko come in and put his lunch up. They just kept going, and I just slowly like backed out of the I backed out of the teacher's lunch, and I felt extremely bad.
I just wanted one of them to be like, like, I'm with you.
Yeah, so that, yeah, there's a yeah, that, and that happened within the last like month. I mean, it was that reason.
That's really funny. Yeah, so the rest of the song is a lot of just like I don't know what you call it, but he
coolness. It's just tight.
Yeah, he's repeating some of his lines, really drilling it into you, and then freedom, lots of freedom. You got,
and this is where stuff blows up in the video. This is, yeah,
Yeah, it's freedom from my old self. Like the everything's blown up. His guitar's blowing up. He's like, freedom, free from that person. And he was trying to break up with Sony. There was a lawsuit and a big legal battle, which fast forward, he loses the legal battle. And then he tries to sign with these other people and he does. But ironically, I think in 2004 or something, he re-signs with Sony. So I don't know.
What yeah. It's the Carlos Bell training of George Michael.
That's really funny. And yeah, we got him back after all those years of booing him. And then he fucks us over and makes us cheat. That's my
yeah. Yeah, yeah. No, that's very accurate. Yeah.
Yeah. Should have just left him and kept booing him.
I don't know. 2017 was pretty awesome.
Now Altuve's getting booed, damn it, and it's all his fault. I will say that the end of it is there is a line, I should say, because he's like, you know, you got to give what you take and may not be what you want from me, just the way it's got to be. Lose the face now. I've got to live. I've got to live. I've got to live. I'm like, okay. All right.
Yeah. And he did.
And he did. So, yeah, we talked about the video. There was some other stuff that I wanted to talk about, which, okay, we're going to get to Sinatra's letter. So. Yes. So it's first of all, in September of 1990, he told the LA Times Calendar magazine that he would revert back to living a more private life and do little promotion for the second solo album, Listen Without Prejudice, which is what this was on. He announced, "I won't be talking again until I've got something to say." That's like a big quote. I saw it a lot in the research, "until I've got something to say." He held to this statement, passing up interviews and refusing to tour or to star in his own music videos. Only a week after that story was printed, a letter from Frank Sinatra was published that addressed the George Michael article about the reluctant pop star. Sinatra urged Michael to stop speaking about the tragedy of fame, in quotes, and to be thankful he is not playing to an empty bar every night. Sinatra ended the letter by telling Michael that he should not let his talent be wasted. Those who have talent must hug it, embrace it, nurture it, and share it, lest it be taken away from you as fast as it was loaned to you. Trust me, I've been there. And that's what he wrote. And Michael did not listen to Sinatra, though, and he did not do another interview until 6 years later. So
I can see both sides. Because yeah. Sinatra, I mean, he went from being this, like, mobbed-up guy in Hoboken to playing out in Las Vegas. Basically for the rest of his life after starring in some one of my favorite Frank Sinatra tidbits was the original screenplay of Die Hard. The concept of that became Die Hard was written in like the early 70s, and it was written with Frank Sinatra as John McClane in mind. And like, I'm a big Die Hard guy here. If like someone asked me like, what's your favorite movie of all time, like depending on if I was on like a podcast or something, then I would say, like, On the Waterfront, Citizen Kane, something highbrow. It's Die Hard 3. Die Hard 3 is my favorite movie of all time.
You and my husband can go hold hands into the sunset. How do you feel about RoboCop? Because then maybe you guys can get married.
Yeah. So Sinatra, I think Sinatra is coming from a place of like, he's been there, but like, is that what George Michael would have wanted, to just spend all year in Las Vegas singing the same songs over and over again?
No.
Because like his career would indicate no, like he would be more than happy to just disappear. And the song and the video for Freedom 90 does all of the work for him. Like he doesn't have to do another interview. He doesn't have to tour, because the video and the song is freaking cool. And that's the hard part.
Yeah. Yeah. And you know, I'm sure he was like, well, I think I understand where you're coming from, but like, we're all different. We're all coming at this fame differently. And maybe you didn't have like horrible depression over this. And maybe you weren't gay, Sinatra. There's a lot going on here.
Yeah, there's a lot of, you are not on parallel paths here. Like this is a very divergent path that George Michael has taken on the road of fame.
Yes. And so, you know, we don't have to, in the Wham episode we did in December, we went more into his life where we talked about, you know, him getting sick and then having pneumonia and then his mother dying of cancer and then, you know, him getting arrested and coming out and all this stuff. And he took it in stride. He even wrote a song kind of making fun of, like, you know, what happened when he got arrested for lewd conduct and stuff. But I mean, it didn't break him by any means. But
was that the Outside song?
Yes. Yes.
That song's cool. I don't care. Yeah.
Exactly. And then, yes, he died very young, age 53, of heart failure on Christmas Day, which was fucking wild because everybody played the shit out of his song last Christmas.
And that was what, 2019?
Yeah. What did I say?
I guess recent.
Oh, it's 2016.
2016. So, I mean, yeah. Okay. Well, if the 80s and 90s don't exist, then that 2019 to 2016, that's pretty close. So I remember I don't know exactly where I was. I mean, Philip Seymour Hoffman's death was on my birthday, and that affected me extremely deeply.
Oh.
But I remember I was super bummed out because I mean, I'm 43. He's 53.
Yep.
And I'm in way worse shape than George Michael probably was. Like that's alarming. So
it's terrifying.
I was shaken by George Michael's passing.
Yeah. I always hate hearing about men having heart attacks. Like, what was it? Joe Strummer was like 50 or something, the same way. And you're just like, I'm 45. What is it?
We haven't lived as hard a life as Joe Strummer did, though.
That's true.
I don't know. I'm kind of looking at mileage and the tread on my tires and whatnot. I'm like, yeah. I make some bad decisions every now and then, but nothing crazy.
Yeah. Let's hope. And then I can't remember all the details. Ben talked about it at length on the other episode. It was after his death that people found out like his philanthropy, like how much money he donated to charities and stuff, and didn't want the recognition for it, which was wild. It's always so great when you hear about that.
Yeah. But it's also like bittersweet. Like, man, could we have celebrated this while you were still alive? Like that would have been super cool, because I feel like, not that George Michael ever became like a caricature of himself, ironically, the way that Sinatra did. But you know, I don't know that there should be a musical, you know, of George Michael songs, but I don't know that he would have wanted that. I don't know that he would have wanted the Las Vegas residencies. I don't know that. Like I think, you know, from 1990 to 2016, he kind of operated on his own terms. And the duet with Elton John on the Don't Let the Sun Go Down on Me, like that's one of the greatest duets that's ever been recorded. Like, I mean, he didn't say a whole lot publicly, but what he did release, like, held up. Like, I mean, like, credit to George Michael for not going down the throwaway commercial path.
Yeah, for real. And what he did, he won a Grammy for, like, what's the duet? I Knew You Were Waiting for Me. Who did he do that with?
Was that Dionne Warwick?
Aretha. It was Aretha.
That's it. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. He had some quality stuff. And I'm always just super impressed by anyone as famous and as good looking as him who really lacks an ego. Like the way he wasn't like, look at how much money I'm donating, and like didn't even want to tour, didn't want to do videos. Those are my favorite people all the time. I have a real problem with egomaniacs.
And it's the wake me up before you go guy. Like that's what's cool. Like it's the, you know, what could have become just a one hit wonder.
Yeah.
Like turned into a legit like credit to society and benefit to society on pretty much all accounts.
Yeah. And I mean, and I think he knew that was a candy pop song and he loved candy pop, but he was also like, look, I'm a really good writer. Like there was some history, like the first demo tape he did was Careless Whisper. He wrote that like on his walk to work or bus ride to work. He like wrote Careless Whisper in his head. And then they made a demo of that. And I love that song. It's one of the best.
Before he was an Astro, that's when I became a Josh Reddick fan, when he used that as his walk-up music. Yes. He used Careless Whisper. Because it was all like Limp Bizkit and like it was just like terrible like cock rock. That I remember Craig Biggio came up to different U2 songs.
Yes,
I remember
that was his favorite band. Yeah.
But like when Josh Reddick's thrown to the plate and you get that saxophone, like that's legitimately funny.
I think I've talked to you about this. We were talking about like the songs that just like you're losing your mind in the grocery store. Like whoever's the grocery store DJ at HEB is like just gets me. And then like man, you're just going through the aisle like, I'm never gonna dance again. And you're just like, move, I'm in my zone.
The other day, my local HEB was playing Spoon. And I'm like, what is happening here? Like, it's like Third Eye Blind. And I'm like, wait, I'm old enough that the songs that I was in high school, like jamming out to, are now being played in the grocery store. But like, mm-hmm. also like, shout out to Who Picked Spoon, like for the grocery store mix. Like, that's cool.
I know. Every now and then, like, my HEB here in Friendswood, I'm like, who's in charge of this playlist? Because they're playing Depeche Mode. Like, shit. Like, where are you?
Yeah. No, like, let's be friends on Spotify.
Oh, it's great. Okay, this is a long episode. It's a long song, but it's worth it. But before I get to your guilty pleasure and stuff, I need to do a Patreon drawing. So
yes.
Yay. So once again, James, thank you for being a Patreon member. And for other people listening, it's $5 a month. Go to patreon.com/rockthecashbar, rockthecashbar podcast. I don't remember. You can figure it out. And once a month we draw a name and then you get to pick a song that we talk about. May not have you on as a guest, but you know, James is a professional and he can do it.
I will be on this show literally whenever you want.
Okay. Oh, it's Corbin's dad. We have Charles Gallagher, who is in Ireland now, and he listens religiously and watches the podcast on YouTube. And he's been telling me some ideas, and I already forgot all of them. For he said when his name's drawn, he thinks he knows what song he wants to do. So I'll have to give him a call.
That's awesome.
It's good to have the older person because a lot of times he listens and he's like, I just don't know the artist. And I was like, listen anyway, you know, learn a song.
Yeah, learn something. I'm a regular listener.
And, oh, thank you.
And I very much enjoy this podcast. It's one of two podcasts that I don't even listen to Lima Time. Like, I do it and I do not listen back. So I listen to this one and then there's another weird serial. It's not serial. Like, it's not like, it's
like one of those.
I'm not, but it's a story. It's nonfiction. It's not nonfiction. It's fiction. But yeah, so that one and this one. It's all I listen to.
Oh, thank you. Okay. So, and well, what I like about his dad is, you know, we get stuck in like the music we like in the time frame and our guests too. But you know, he was listening to music in the 1950s, and he's like, "I want you to do those songs." I'm like, "Well, bring it. Give it to me. Give me your favorite song from, you know, your teenage years." And I was talking to him and I mentioned this previously on a podcast that we get stuck in the music that we listen to as teenagers because that's when we had time to do nothing else but absorb music. We didn't have responsibilities and other things to do. And it's hard to keep up when you get older and you have kids and you have a job. And even to now, there's no MTV. And I'm always like, how are people finding new music? I don't even know how you guys are doing this.
Right.
You have to like go search it out. I feel like you have to hunt it down now. And if you're not constantly listening to FM pop, top 40 radio, I don't even know how these people are getting it.
No. My wife's brother, my brother-in-law, he was like, hey, here's an album I think you'd like. And he was 100% correct. And it was about a year ago. And I think I've listened to that album, like honestly, maybe 500 times in the last year. So
word of mouth is still powerful, I guess.
Drip Field by Goose. That was my album of the year.
Never even heard of that.
Yeah, no, I'll send it to you. It's incredible.
Okay. All right. Okay. Do you have your last guilty pleasure song was Breathless by The Coors.
Yes.
I hear all the time and did not know that they were Irish.
They're all related. Like they're brothers, like four brothers. It's one brother and like three sisters.
Yeah.
Yeah, I actually, because we're in the weight room a couple times a week with soccer. Last week, I got to the Bluetooth first and I played Breathless by The Coors, immediately followed by Stop by the Spice Girls. And I have been banned from the Bluetooth. And like Tuesday, today's Wednesday, yesterday, like the strength and conditioning coach was like, someone hop on the Bluetooth. And I went, I got it. And 50 girls were like, no. And so I've been banned from DJing. And I'm
these are high school girls. Spice Girls was made for them. They're not feeling it.
They were not into, I might've been the dance that I was doing in the middle of the weight room. That could have been off-putting in a minor way.
Spice Girls didn't hit them the way it was supposed to. It was supposed to be the videos and that. It hit them with you.
Yeah. No, I'm not the intro to the Spice Girls that if you really want to appreciate them.
All right. All right. So, okay. So what is your, what's a new guilty pleasure song?
It's not a new guilty pleasure, but it's definitely a guilty pleasure. Also with a cool video. And also with a similar, I feel like, career path as the song that we spent the last hour discussing. New guilty, well, this guilty pleasure is going to be Rock DJ by Robbie Williams. I don't want to rock DJ, but you're making me feel so nice. When's it gonna stop, DJ? Cause you're keeping me up all night.
Oh, I forgot that Robbie Williams came up in this, and I was like, man, what happened to him? Like, he was so big for a hot minute. Where did he go?
Yeah, no, that there you go. That's a future episode that I'm gonna absolutely listen to multiple times.
Robbie Williams, Rock DJ. I feel like I
also
should know
this. The video is nuts. It's absolutely insane.
Okay, I'll have to look it up. I'm gonna play a clip, but yeah, I mean, Robbie Williams was so big, and then like just gone. Like, what happened to him? All right, all right. I'll just leave you on for the end. Let's see, guilty. Promote yourself. You want to promote Lima Time Time? Anything else you want to promote?
So Lima Time Time is a fun podcast that we try to do regularly, which doesn't always work out, but it's like podcast herpes. Like, we have a flare up of Lima Time Time, and we'll come out with like two in like 4 days. I had the reason that Lima Time Time exists because of a blog that I started in 2008 called Astros County. And I did it for a little over 12 years. So early 2021, I was like, I'm burned out. I can't do it. And so I stopped doing it and then started back up on Monday. So astroscounty.com, basically like some different stats about each Astros game and then any relevant links and then anything that interesting that I've come up with. And there is a musical selection for every single day. So, and I've made a playlist on Spotify. It's called the Hot Links. It's the Astros County Hot Links, and so it's up to a good 30 hours of just a Spotify playlist, and it's turned into like, these are the favorite songs I've ever heard. I listen to this playlist more than really anything else other than Goose.
That's really fun.
So Lima Time Time, astroscounty.com.
There you go. You guys go check out both of those, please. Next week, I don't know what's happening. Our schedule has gotten bonkers. Usually we go like, you know, Ben, I choose a song, Ben chooses a song, Patreon guest. We have a guest lined up, but we also keep promising a Lyle Lovett episode. So I'm going to find out what Ben wants to do. So next week, it's either going to be Lyle Lovett, or we're going to have our friend Kelly Butler, who was a comedian back with us back in the days of the old Laugh Stop. And she wants to do some wet ass pussy. And I cannot wait to hear Ben read those lyrics off a piece of paper.
One guest should actually be Lyle Lovett. Like, that's, I'm proposing that.
Yeah, I mean, I don't know if, you didn't hear this. We did a podcast with this guy in New York City who knows, he does a podcast with a lot of kind of, I wouldn't say washed up, but like older rock dudes. Like, he's like, I could get you like the basis of this old band. And I was like, we'll take it. Like, give us some real members, because what I would love to happen to this podcast in the future, if it were to ever like blow up, is have the first 30 minutes of me and Ben going through the lyrics, saying what we think the song meant or whatever. And that person who wrote it is listening and not speaking. And then the second 30 minutes, they come on and just tell us how we fucking wrecked it and got it all wrong.
That would be incredible. Absolutely incredible.
I know. Wouldn't that be fun? Anyway, I can dream. All right. Thank you so much for coming on, everybody. Go listen to Lima Time Time and Astros County blog. Is it a blog?
It's a
blog. Okay.
It's still on Blogger. Yeah.
Okay. Awesome. And you want to Vogue with me? Vogue. Rock the Cash Bar is produced by Diane Gallagher, music by Chuck Savage and Eddie Hawkins. Special thank you to Jeremy Essig for 6 Degrees and to Sara Wessling for the Guilty Pleasures vocals. Our website is rockthecashbarpodcast.com, and there you can find links to our Spotify playlist and to our Patreon. Thank you for tuning in, and we will see you next week.